Welcome, everyone. We're thrilled to have you joining us for Public Access, Your Rights and Responsibilities as a Watershed Citizen, a Waterside Chat with Hackensack Riverkeeper Program Director and Captain Hugh Carola. Thanks so much for joining us, Hugh.
Happy to be here, Abby.
My name is Abby. I'm the Program Manager at Waterspirit. Waterspirit is a nonpartisan nonprofit center for spiritual ecology, and we are sponsored by the Sisters of St. Joseph of Peace. And we are talking to Hugh Carola today. A little bit about Hugh. Hugh is Hackensack Riverkeeper's representative on 5 regional environmental coalitions. He is also part of the board of Waterspirit, and also the board of EarthShare, New Jersey, the Fyke Nature Association, and as a trustee of the Alliance for New Jersey Environmental Education, also known as ANJEE. Hugh has served 2 terms as ANJEE's president and received the group's Outstanding Environmental Educator Award in 2005. And I know you have a ton of info for us today, and we're very excited to learn more about Watershed. Healthy watersheds are vital for a flourishing environment and economy. So my first question for you, Hugh, is what are our rights and responsibilities as a watershed citizen?
Wow, good question. So let's start by just defining what a watershed is. Sometimes people think a watershed is the land that is directly next to a water body. Sometimes people think it's only the natural areas of wetlands or woodlands that surround water bodies. But in fact, all of the land that drains into a body of water, whether it be woods or wetlands or parking lots or the roof of your home or the place where you work, is all part of a watershed. There is not a single square inch of land anywhere in the world that is not part of a watershed. Whatever we do on the land, whether it be to cut down a tree or to pave over an area of open space, or whether we do something like build a rain garden, or we restore an area of wetlands, whatever we do on the land certainly affects what happens to the water for good or for ill. So our job, everyone's job as a watershed citizen, is to A, understand that, and recognize that as humans, as stewards of the land, we're also stewards of the water. We're essentially called to be that sentient bit of creation that can choose what we do. So that being said, our basic responsibilities are to care for creation as if it was our home. One of the things I learned not too long ago, but is the fact that in the book of Genesis, when it refers to humans having dominion over the earth, the word dominion doesn't mean to dominate, but it means domicile. In other words, to treat it as your home, to welcome people to your home, to keep it healthy and clean and sustainable. So that's our responsibility. Understand that what we do on the land, if we choose to use a pesticide or herbicide, or we choose to plant this sort of plant that is not native to North America, or we choose to, whatever choices we make, it's obviously down to us, and it can either be for, you know, great benefit, you know, a neutral situation, or in some cases it could literally be a bad thing, a negative. Our rights as watershed citizens, among other things, is your right, my right, everyone's right to access the flowing waters. You and I and every human being on this earth has the right by divine and natural law to access the flowing waters of the world, be that the beaches, be that the flowing rivers, the wetlands, the bays, interface between flowing water and land. Now that literally comes from the Codex Justinianus, or the Code of Justinian. Justinian was one of the last, I wouldn't say the last major emperors of the Roman Empire, back when the empire was centered at Constantinople. Justinian, while unlike other Roman emperors who had other issues that they dealt with, for Justinian, sex and debauchery was not one of them. His thing was money. He liked gold and silver. That was his thing. So if you just kind of put that aside for a second, he did also have this interesting idea that in this new world that he saw himself in, that he saw himself as the leader of, there were centuries of wisdom, biblical wisdom, secular wisdom from the ancient Greeks and Roman Empire and going back to the Roman Republic, and so much more. The new Christian world was beginning or had begun and was developing. And his idea was to cast about for all of the wisdom that he could find, that his scholars could find, to draw it all together and to create a code of law for the new world order as he saw it at the time. And there's a lot in there, but for our purposes, and I'm gonna paraphrase a bit, it is that it is a law of nature and nature's God that there are certain things held in common to all human beings, regardless of their station in life, like be they an emperor or be they a slave. You are a human being, therefore you have the right to breathe the air. You have the right to drink clean water. You have the right to access the water. And again, those places where the land connects with the water. You have a right to go to the water and to cast a line in and to take a fish or gather shellfish and eat of that fruits of the waters, because it's yours by right, that no emperor, no king, no potentate, no one can tell you no to that. Now that bit of wisdom, you know, this germ of truth kind of stayed there, and you know, yes and no, but mostly no. Because when you add, you know, potentates and kings and emperors and popes and the rest of them, right, I'm in power, I rule, you can't go here. That's my water, that's my shore. So, but this germ of truth, as so many truths do, they don't die, they don't get, you know, destroyed, they get covered and they get hidden. And so we fast forward to the Magna Carta. One of the things that King John the Usurper was doing wrong was currying favor with the nobles that were on his side by giving land grants to the tideland grants to the seashore of England. And the loyal nobles knew this was wrong, that every Englishman's right was to go to the water's edge and to be able to go there freely without being told no. And that's one of the things that got King John in trouble and that forced him to eventually sign the Magna Carta, Code of Osprey. Sorry, you can't see it. There's an osprey, almost dove. Codifying the rights of all Englishmen to go to the water's edge. That became a major portion of English common law. That is also the basis under which our own constitution, our own founding documents are based. We're based on English common law. So one often can say that the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is included in our rights to get to the water's edge. Life, that's obvious. Liberty, obvious. Pursuit of happiness. Some scholars just blithely say, it means property, it means the right to property. Yes, but it also means the right to the commons. And the commons is the water's edge, the flowing waters, the beaches, the wetlands. So in New Jersey, we actually codified that in New Jersey constitutional law, that the public trust doctrine, which goes back to our founding documents, which goes back to the Magna Carta, which goes back to Justinian's Code, is clearly and evidently a major part of New Jersey state law. You and I, New Jersey citizens, have these rights. That's our right. And how we exercise those rights is one of the best ways to do that is to be aware, to be active, to advocate for clean water issues, to advocate for protecting habitats, to advocate for protecting wildlife, protecting, again, everyone's rights, particularly the rights of indigenous communities, marginalized communities, people whose local water bodies are polluted. You know, they've got a right to go to the Passaic River or to go to the waterfront of Camden. And yes, I will defend those rights to my dying day, but I also have to explain to those good people that it's not safe to eat those fish yet. So together we help ideally create this force of advocacy that will fight the good fight now and into the future. And the long game, the long-term goal is that we will someday, I won't, you might, but our kids and grandkids certainly will be able to go to any waters, the edge of any waters in the state of New Jersey and beyond, to go to the water's edge, cast in a line or put down a crab trap and not be afraid of catching something from what they catch on the line or in the trap. So that's pretty much it in a bit of a large nutshell. But that's it. You know, we have rights. We have responsibilities. You can't just let the government. Here's the thing too. You can't, oh, well, somebody else will do it. No, there's no they out there who do good things. There's people like us. When we come together and we organize and we create organizations like Riverkeeper and Waterspirit and such all, we can do great things, absolutely great things, but we've got to, you know, make that happen. So.
Agreed. Yeah.
That for an answer.
Excellent. That was excellent. Yeah. So fascinating and important and just awesome. Thank you. Can you tell us a little bit about your surroundings and the Hackensack River itself?
Sure. Well, I'm sitting at the helm of the Robert H. Boyle II. The Robert H. Boyle II is one of the two pontoon boats, 30 feet long, that Hackensack Riverkeeper operates. These are our floating classrooms. They are our twin flagships. We've had boats in the water since Hackensack Riverkeeper was founded in 1997 by my boss, Captain Bill Sheehan. Captain Bill operates the Geraldine Therese, which is over there to my port side. This is the river. You can see there's Route 3 down that way, and there's sunset just coming down nicely, lovely. The river begins up in New City, New York, in Rockland County. For about 22 miles, the river flows in a southern direction. It is all fresh water. In those 22 and a half miles of fresh water, there are four reservoirs. And from those reservoirs, about 1 million people depend on their drinking water. Every time they turn on the tap, 1 million people get their water from the upper half of the Hackensack River. But down here where I am, in the town of Carlstadt, New Jersey, in Bergen County, in the lovely place known as the Meadowlands, here the water is not fresh, it is brackish. It's brackish because in 1923, the Hackensack Water Company built a dam at that 22 and a half mile marker, basically, to create the Oradell Reservoir. And for the first time, the river that used to be a kind of a mini Delaware, in other words, there were no ocean tides here. In 1923, ocean tides were established, and we literally have two rivers in one, that freshwater northern half and the brackish or salty tidal southern half, where I am right now. And this is where we do a lot of our tours, because again, this is all public access land and public access waterway. So this is my desk for about 6 months of the year on board this boat, named after the founder of the Waterkeeper movement. Robert H. Boyle was a wonderful man. In the late 1960s, he got involved with a bunch of fishermen who'd lost their jobs because the fish were no longer safe to eat. Striped bass were no longer safe to eat, being caught from the Hudson River. And beyond the Hudson River, all of the waters of the New York, New Jersey Harbor Estuary the lower Hackensack, the lower Passaic, the lower Raritan, all the waterways around New York City, the Hudson, and, you know, this tremendous area that we call the Hudson-Raritan Estuary or the New York-New Jersey Harbor Estuary, used to be a tremendous source of protein for millions and millions of people. It can be again. So with our colleagues in conservation in the Waterkeeper movement, the spirit of Bob Boyle and the founders of our movement really give us the strength and the inspiration to keep on going, to engage people of all ages to do what we do for today and for the future.
That's really cool. And it does look like there's a beautiful sunset happening right now behind you.
Yeah, it is not half bad. Let me give a little bit of a little bit more of a movement over there. Color over there.
Beautiful.
Yeah, so that's wind blowing a bit from the south. Southwest today, so looking really awesome. Nice. It's a nice time of the year. No bugs.
Great. So you are also one of the captains on the eco cruises offered at Hackensack Riverkeeper. Can you tell us a little more about these cruises? You mentioned them a little, but
Sure. We it was the eco cruises were born out of a necessity. The necessity being that when Captain Bill Sheehan started Hackensack Riverkeeper, he did so in 1997 in the middle of a pitched battle between the forces of development, actually sprawl developers, and a fledgling conservation movement that was just beginning, not fledgling in the sense of the movement, but fledgling in the sense of looking at more urban areas. In the last 50 to 100 years in New Jersey and in the region, the highlands, the pine lands, the sour lands, the Delaware Bay shore, many important places have been protected in New Jersey. But among the last ones to receive any kind of a focus have been the more urban areas. Here in the Meadowlands, Meadowlands is part of Hudson County and South Bergen, not exactly the garden spots in anyone's thinking. Similar is true of the waterfront of Camden, New Jersey, and parts of Trenton. There are a lot of places, the Lower Passaic River, that where many, many people live, where there used to be green spaces, where there could be green spaces again. But here in the Meadowlands, by the late 90s, there were still about 7,000 acres of wetlands, coastal marshlands. They were crisscrossed by about 1,500 acres of open water, so habitat about 8,500 acres, all of which were under siege by pressures for development, by the politicians who supported the sprawl developers, by a mindset that said there's nothing good in those meadowlands. They're stinking swamps, they're dirty, they're polluted, they're not worth saving, the waters, nothing lives there, don't even bother. Well, if you're just going back and forth, yes, there are. No, there isn't. You know, the winner is going to be the person who has the more lawyers, the more money, the more consultants, the more time to spend spewing their lies. What Captain Bill Sheehan had and the people who had begun to work with him in the late 90s was that we had the truth. We knew that, there is a terrible legacy of pollution, but that lies mainly in the sediments, not in the water. That every year there are more species of birds, there are more species of fish, there are more species of mammals, and there are more people rediscovering the Meadowlands and the Hackensack River as a place to recreate, as a place to enjoy and explore. And the way that Bill got people to see that truth was by the boats. Initially, the Queen Mary E, first boat he had, then the original Robert H. Boyle, then the Edward Abbey, which became the sister ship of the Boyle One, and now the Geraldine Teresa and the Robert H. Boyle Two. By six people, 10 people, however many people at a time, we counteracted the lies by bringing people out into the marshes, onto the river, and let them see for themselves you know, what was really here. And for so many years, and still to this day, although not as much, the phrase we heard over and over and over again was, wow, I had no idea. I had no idea this was all here. I had no idea I was going to see these birds, like, you know, in the shadow of the Empire State Building, almost literally. So for us, it was a necessity to help people really get to see the reality of the Meadowlands and the river as it is today, not as it used to be. They become just fun, wonderful ways. We take out children of all ages, from pre-K to, you know, to high school, college students, graduate school, senior clubs, nature clubs, women's clubs, garden clubs, clubs of all description, family groups, the general public. In a normal non-COVID year, we take out about 3,000 people on these boats, like 10 at a time, or you know, 20 at a time using both boats or thereabouts. So it's a labor of love for Captain Bill and myself. We both hold U.S. Coast Guard captain's licenses, a true labor of love, and just to see people's faces and they get to see the reality of this place, it's well worth it. Because when we get them on the boat, when we get them on the water, we get them, you know. They become members of our crew, so to speak. They understand and they become more of that constituency for this river and its watershed, and ultimately for their own watersheds if they're from someplace else.
Yeah, absolutely. What a great way to get people to experience the Hackensack River. Yeah.
When my mother was alive, she said, she would say to me, she would say, babe, you've never been so happy since you got this job. She said, the only day that I think you were happy was the day you got married. And moms are never wrong. Let's face it, you know. She was right. Yeah, absolutely. I spent 16 years working retail. Sometimes it was okay. Other times it was pure hell. But in 1999, I was able to, because my wife, Dorothy, figured out that we could live on one salary for 6 months. She gave me 6 months to go and find a job that I would love and that would not come home swearing about. And I went looking, and I had met Captain Bill earlier that year, the year before. And I went to his office and said, hey, you have any need for someone who can put string sentences together well, you know? And he goes, oh yeah. He said, I got a ton of work going on. We're in this battle and we need help. And he said, but I have no money for you right now. He said, but you give me those 6 months, I promise you, I'll get you paid. That was in January of 1999. 6 months later in July, checks started coming through. So this has been my career since 1999. And I have been the actual program director of Riverkeeper, Hackensack Riverkeeper, since 2001. So in January of 2021, I will be 20 years officially. So
wow.
That's most folks can't say they've worked in the same job for that amount of time. But when you, as any of us knows, when you love what you do, it's a cliche, but it's not working. You know, I still get tired and beat up, and I still get cranky from time to time, but it's wonderful. This is your desk. Again, though.
Yeah. My dad used to say, if you do what you love as your job, you'll never work one day in your life.
Dads are also very, very correct about those sorts of
things. Well, so I'm so excited to hear about your almost 20th anniversary. That's very
cool. Right.
And you talked a little bit about the eco cruises, but in addition to those, what other types of public access opportunities are there for folks who live near the Hackensack?
Okay. There are a number of public access points that we help to create. So you can go paddling. If you own your own canoe or kayak, there is public access at here at River Barge Park in Karlstad, across the river in Secaucus at Mill Creek Point Park, Secaucus, and at Laurel Hill County Park in Secaucus. Down in Bayonne, On Newark Bay, there is a wonderful beach, a small beach, not for swimming though, but for launching a kayak at Rutkowski Park in Bayonne. There's also a boat launch at 16th Street Park in Bayonne as well. There is public access on the Passaic River in the city of Newark for the first time ever in the Ironbound section of that wonderful city right there on Raymond Boulevard. There is a floating dock there. It's not a launch dock, but you can bring a boat down there. You can also fish along the banks of the Passaic River, the Hackensack River, in Newark, in Secaucus, in Hackensack, and a number of places. There's also a wonderful canoe and kayak launched at Overpeck Park in Teaneck. Now, Overpeck Creek is a tributary of the lower Hackensack River. There are a number of places now where you can go fishing and go kayaking. If you don't own your own boat, Hackensack Riverkeeper operates two kayak liveries, rental businesses, or parts of our mission, at Laurel Hill Park, Secaucus, and also at Overpeck Park in Teaneck. So we'll be open until the 18th of October, weather permitting, and the creek don't rise too high. And again, the fishing is really good, but it is catch and release. One of the best places to catch striped bass is over across the river from me right now at Mill Creek Point Park in Secaucus. Later in the year, December, January, February, when it gets cold, the colder the water, the bigger the bass. That's what the fishermen know. But for the most part, though, great blue heron just flying past. There he goes. Oh, there you go. The fishing for people, okay. So for people my age, 60 and over, you know, the state of New Jersey says 4 meals of striped bass per year from this river is okay. But for people I'm looking at here, no, you're all too young. But catch and release is definitely the way to go. And part of our long game is to make this river safe for anybody of any age or any station in life to be able to come this river and go fishing and not worry about it. That's part of our job too. But it's all about getting you people to the water. There are also opportunities for river cleanups that we do. Folks can go on our website. It's hackensackriverkeeper.org. They just click around the list of tours and the big boat tours are booked for the season. But there's still cleanups they're doing going on. And you also can also find a list of many of our colleagues. We don't operate in a vacuum. There are groups that we work with. The Nature Program Cooperative represents, about 20 other conservation groups in the Bergen, Hudson, Sake area, kind of like, where we've got a lot of people that operate nature centers, do environmental education programs, and really give folks the opportunity to get out, if not on the water or near the water, on the trail, in the field, birding, hawk watching, botanizing, a lot of good environmental ed. A lot of it being done, you know, COVID safe. So you can definitely, you know, by yourself, with some friends, with your family, there's a lot of great opportunities to get out on the water and really exercise those rights as watershed citizens, for sure.
Awesome. Yeah. And you saw a blue heron just now. Yeah. What else can be seen on the river? What other creatures and fun things?
Well, in the fall, we've got, well, the fall is great because you got migration seasons happening. So hawk migration is still going on. So we've got bald eagles coming through, peregrine falcon coming through, red-tailed hawk coming through, a peregrine falcon, I said that ospreys by. We had 16 pairs of osprey nesting within our neighborhood here, along the river or nearby. We had thousands upon thousands of shorebirds, sandpipers and plovers coming through. Migration season in the Meadowlands is wonderful. Spring is great. Fall is better because it's more drawn out, because none of the birds have sex on the brain. In the spring, they're all on their way up to the nesting grounds. But now in the fall, they're taking their time. Our charismatic megafauna, though, would be the herons and the egrets. In any given year, there's up to 2,000 pairs of herons of about 7 different species that nest in the greater New York, New Jersey harbor region. And many of them use the meadowlands and the tributaries of the marshes as their major foraging places. So great egret, snowy egret, great blue heron, as you saw, a tricolored heron, great, I'm sorry, black crown night heron, yellow crown night heron, green heron, least bittern. Yeah, we have a lot of them here. Cormorants by the literally the thousands, gulls, terns, black skimmers. There's about 75 species of birds that nest directly in the meadowlands each year, and another 200 that either nest nearby and use it during the season to feed, or use it as a migratory stopover, or in the case of many species of ducks and other waterfowl, they're here in the wintertime. So it's an amazing And I said in the 1990s, right? It was what, 8,500 acres of habitat left. You know how much is still here? 8,500. Because we beat them. We beat the people who are trying to destroy the wetlands. We defeated the liars, and we defeated the enablers and the feckless politicians who supported sprawl development because we've always done it that way. Oh, really? Well, there's a new way of doing it. Okay, there's a new way of looking upon these urban wilderness areas, as we call them. And by getting tens of thousands, literally tens of thousands of people on our side, understanding their rights and their responsibilities, creating the constituency for these areas here, we won the battle. We won the battle when, you know, so it's cool. So because we won the battle, these wetlands are still here. They were protected officially and permanently in 2004. And what we're hoping for, the end game we're slowly, hopefully moving towards, is the creation of a brand new state park. That's my personal goal for the Meadowlands. It could be something else along those lines, but you know, everybody knows what a park is, right? You don't have to explain what a park is. And the neat thing is the state already owns pretty much all those wetlands anyway. So just order the big brown signs and make it happen. So that's part of our job.
That would be so cool.
That's awesome. It would be.
Yeah.
And that I should be able to live to see.
Yeah, absolutely. I think so.
Cool.
I have a few more questions for you. What impacts do humans have on the Hackensack River watershed, or any watersheds, I guess? I could also ask, what are some threats to watersheds?
Okay. Well, like I said earlier, your choices. So understand that, like, when it rains, the watershed, okay, watersheds, the way a watershed works is, when it rains, the land sheds that storm water towards the closest body of water, whether it be a creek, a stream, the river itself, the ocean, what have you. So, you know, watch out what you put on your lawn or in your gardens, okay? Do organic, do less pesticides, if you have to use any at all. Be smart, be diligent, don't just broadcast stuff. Choose what to do. Make sure your car's in good shape. If your car's leaking oil, yeah, it's leaking oil on the road, and then the rain washes that oil into the water, because those storm drains don't just go away. Storm drains go to the closest body of water. It just makes the watershed go faster, you know? So keep your cars in good shape. Conserve water, whether you're watering your lawn or filling your pool or brushing your teeth, you know, conserve water. Choose native plants whenever possible. Or if you're going to do, you know, like ornamentals, pick things like tulips that aren't going to go and like take over an area. You know, there are lots of great native plant nurseries in New Jersey. Pinelands Nursery is one of them. There are others as well. Just go online, Google it. Native plant nurseries in New Jersey. They're there. Volunteer with, you know, local groups doing cleanups, doing invasive species removal. doing native tree planting. There's a lot of great stuff that folks can do. As far as threats go, fortunately, in New Jersey, there are very, very few remaining active industrial dischargers. Here in the Hackensack, there are three major threats to the quality of the water here. One is combined sewers. Now, I could do a whole hour on that, but suffice it to say, a combined sewer is a 19th century technology that still exists today in the 21st in some older cities, like Patterson, my old hometown, like Newark and Bayonne and Jersey City, where underneath the ground, there's one big pipe. Okay, and into the one big pipe goes stormwater, from the rain, and wastewater from when we flush or stuff goes down the drain. Day like today, no problem. That big pipe is plenty big enough, and whatever is in the pipe goes to the local treatment plant where it's properly dealt with, the solids are removed, dewatered, sent to landfills. The wastewater is filtered, disinfected, aerated, and discharged cleanly into the receiving waters. But like we had the other day here, it rained pretty heavily, and those old big pipes aren't big enough to handle the increased flow, and therefore, at about 220 some locations in the state of New Jersey, raw sewage legally pours into our local waterways, into this river, the Hackensack, the Passaic River, the Raritan, the Rahway, the Hudson, the Delaware. Yeah, it's a sin, really, if you look at it that way. It should not exist because it's long gone, but it's still here because we haven't yet figured out a way to come up with the money to help our cities replace those old systems. So combined sewers is probably the biggest one of all. The second one I mentioned earlier, just runoff from roads. Pick up after your dog, okay? Don't feed geese, okay? Feeding waterfowl is actually against the law in New Jersey, okay? Because it unnaturally concentrates them and their droppings where it doesn't belong. Don't feed the geese. I'm a grandparent. I'm not going to bring my granddaughter out there. I'll let her look at them and wave at the geese, but she ain't going to feed them, okay? And the last one would be the landfills that have never been properly sealed up. Here in the Meadowlands, four of them were properly sealed, and then two others down in Jersey City, but we still have another half a dozen former garbage dumps that have never been properly sealed up. By that I mean, when it rains on, say, the Malanka landfill in Secaucus, rainwater soaks through this lovely layer of grass and trees into a layer of dirt, into a whole lot of layers of God knows what. A whole lot of trouble, a whole lot of absolutely like evil stuff that was buried and dumped decades ago. And as that rainwater percolates down through all those nasty layers, the rainwater turns into leachate. And leachate is simply a kind of a fancy way of saying garbage juice. And that leaches into the river at the base of the landfill. So those are the three major problems. And of course, there is remaining historic pollution from years ago, mainly in sediments that needs to be literally removed, excavated out. The only way to fix that problem is to get rid of that stuff, But mainly the new sources of pollution are all weather related. So we just advocate near constantly for towns and governments to get the money to fix the problems that they can, and that for the remediation of the older problems, historic pollution and landfills. So it's an ongoing, I guess, a long game struggle. There's no quick answer. I mean, it's not hard. It's not difficult to understand. It's easy, but it's not quick. That's where we're at.
Yeah. How do you suggest people take action, since this is such an important part of our world and our ecosystems and the health of ourselves and our planet?
Vote for candidates who are pro-environment. That is extremely important, and it's job number one. okay? If you care in any way, shape, or form about the environment, you have to vote for those people who, in your opinion, represent what you believe in as far as the environment. Now, obviously, we have, each of us has other things that we care about. I would hope that the environment, clean water, public access, protecting wildlife is high up on most people's lists. That's important. We have to exercise those rights to vote, to choose the leadership that will, you know, carry us through into this, through this 21st century. What's happening now is a crime. There are from the US to Brazil to the Horn of Africa to Australia to all around the world, there are hard fought environmental protections being rolled back. There are laws being repealed. There are indigenous people being slaughtered because they're defending like their traditional way of life, their traditional lands and waters. You know, there are people here in this country who are their health and their lives and livelihood are being put at risk because polluted sites are not being cleaned up because pollution is being allowed to be dumped again. This is just unconscionable. This should not be. There was a time not all that long ago when the Clean Water Act, the thing that really animates all water keepers around the world, all 360 of us around the world, the Clean Water Act was passed by an overwhelming supermajority in both houses of Congress, both parties. Supermajority means a majority of Dems and a majority of Republicans voted for it. President Nixon, of course, vetoed it. And a near similar, a near equal supermajority overrode his veto. That's where we used to be not all that long ago. I don't know what it's going to take to get us back to that. But in the meantime, you can't moan and cry about it. We've got to be active. So, you know, you got to advocate. You got to sometimes agitate. You got to stand up, and sometimes you got to act up, you know, intelligently, smartly, legally, but, you know, you can't just let, oh, somebody else will do. No, we are those somebodies that have to be the ones to step up and make good things happen, because that's the only way it ever happens, when folks stand up, make it happen.
Absolutely. Totally agree. How can folks learn more about the Hackensack River projects and what's going on?
Well, like I said, so go to HackensackRiverkeeper.org. Somewhere on the homepage is a place you can sign up for email alerts and information about volunteering. So, you know, it doesn't cost anything to sign up. So please do that. You can get our newsletter. If you can obviously donate to us, donate to Waterspirit as well. We hope that folks would, you know, donate to as many groups as they can afford to do so. I try to support local groups, a local group, a state group, a regional group, and a national or global group. You know, that's my thing. If you can do that too, please, I hope you can do that. If you send us anything, you'll get our newsletter in print. It's really cool. But it's also available online. You can read it on the website as well. But definitely, in the off season, when hopefully we'll be getting a vaccine, we normally do conferences, conventions, but you can reach out to us online and we'll definitely answer questions. We are a resource. We're a resource for the towns and the people who live in our watershed, but we're also a resource for the people who live and work in watersheds, wherever you may be, because as I said earlier, we're all citizens of a watershed. So we can help people understand and help, you know, you come up with, we'll happily do that. Absolutely. Any day of the week, 7 days. That's what we do.
Awesome. Yeah. You guys are a vital resource and we really appreciate that, everything that you guys do. at
Hackensack. And I appreciate being a part of Waterspirit. It's wonderful. It really is. Because, you know, too often, you know, in my line of work, people are just, I mean, there's just not enough of the heart, not enough for the spirit. You know, I mean, I'm in this because of my faith journey and the way I relate to nature on a spiritual plane. I'm not the way some people may be, but it is, there's a real, true, concrete spiritual reality that connects me to the water and to the land and to the creatures and to the people, you know, who have that, who teach us, you know, and help us solidify those connections, you know, whatever our journeys are. So absolutely, it's, you know, it's important for all of us, I think, to really recognize and accept and embrace those spiritual connections, whatever they may be, because to me, that's the bond that really, you know, brings people together and connects people in nature. So that's the way I think about it. And, you know, email me if you want to talk about it some more. So a lot of fun.
Well said, Hugh. Thank you for saying those kind things about Waterspirit. And before we end, does anyone have any other questions for Hugh? Yeah, go for it, Blair.
I've got a simple question with a long preamble. First off, Hugh, thank you for these amazing insights that you're offering to us in this journey that you're taking us on. That part about humans having dominion over the earth, not being related to dominance, but being related to domicile, as in we need to care for our common home. I am definitely going to be passing that thought on. That was amazing. And thank you so much for sharing from your personal journey as well as your professional journey, in which you've seen the ways that direct contact with nature can really lead to the kind of ecological conversion that Pope Francis calls for in Laudato Si. It really adds such depth and urgency to this call to protect public access to waters. So thank you for relating that to your spiritual journey as well as to your journey as an American citizen, how accessing waters is part and parcel of the pursuit of happiness, which is amazing. But, and you started off this whole talk helping us to understand even a little more clearly what a watershed is, that it's not necessarily just the waters that you see. So for people who may be tuning into this talk later, who may not necessarily be as connected with their local watershed, do you have any favorite resources that you can recommend for how people can find out even what their local watershed is, or perhaps even what, you know, what some of the local threats might be, and how to take this, what you've learned at Hackensack, and apply it to their region?
You can, in New Jersey in particular, you can go to the DEP website, or just Google New Jersey watershed management areas. So in New Jersey, we have 20 separate watershed management areas, and each one is unique, obviously, but each one also has an environmental educator who was hired through the AmeriCorps program to be a resource to people and schools and institutions in that watershed region. So definitely go to the DEP website. It's a big part of what they do. You can also, obviously, you know, reach out to any of the major environmental groups that you know of, like New Jersey Audubon Society, New Jersey Conservation Foundation. There are local Audubon chapters as well of National Audubon. Definitely, that's certainly available. There are nature centers from Cape May to High Point in some very urban areas and some very, very rural areas. Just, you know, go online and just, you know, and go to that, go to the waters, really, the watershed management areas website information would be very helpful. Absolutely. Definitely.
Thank you.
You're welcome. We're really losing the light here, kids.
I know. The sun is setting. Are there any final questions for Hugh before we finish our chat?
Well, if anybody has any questions, folks can email me directly. The email address is very similar to my first name, Hugh, which is H-U-G-H at HackensackRiverkeeper.org, just like it sounds, H-A-C-K-E-N-S-A-C-K, riverkeeper.org. no dots, no dashes, no underscore, hugh@hackensackriverkeeper.org. If you please say that you saw this on the YouTube channel of Waterspirit, and let me know you got that, and I will let Blair and Abby know that you saw it, and we'll get you from there. And hopefully we'll see you sometime either along this waterfront or the Rumson waterfront or the ocean or some wonderful place, because whatever waterfront we're talking about, it's yours. It's yours by right. Absolutely. Sound good?
Sounds great, Hugh. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. My pleasure.
This is a pleasure. Yeah, always great to see you and talk to you. And thank you everyone for tuning in. Have a wonderful rest of your night.
All the best. Good night.
Bye.
Good night. Bye now.